Alrighty, so we're set to go. Advanced security features. What we're going to do here today is we're going to go over some of the things that are available. This is not going to be a blood and guts step-by-step on everything, but rather give you a taste of what's available to you from in Xen Project, and to give you pointers on where to go so that when you want to employ these things, you know where to start working. Most of these things that we're going to talk about today, frankly, are not difficult, but you have to make a decision to use them. So if you don't know it's there, you can't decide. So that's basically where we are today, is to try to get you so that you can choose what makes sense for you in your organization and what doesn't. Who am I? I've got a big mouth, and you can see the rest of the stuff online. As I said, we're going to introduce some of the security things. We're going to talk a little bit about a security mindset as well, and then discuss some of the tools that are available, as I said. I won't bother with the presentation outline. So, where are we? How many people are using clouds or are intending on using clouds, okay? So, you know, security in the cloud is one of those bugaboo issues, as we know. But the good news is that Xen Project was designed with the notion of trying to make an enterprise-grade Type 1 hypervisor. That is, it runs bare metal. It was built with the concept of clouds before the term cloud was ever coined. And that's really kind of neat. I don't know if the slide's inside this deck or not, but there was actually a paper done at the very beginning of the project envisioning this concept of a data center that could be reconfigured at will according to the needs. And it was this vision of a cloud back in the days before the term cloud was ever used that was really kind of interesting, and it drove the development of what we see now in Xen Project. As a result, it's not, it shouldn't be a surprise that we see that certain things have come out of the project, because there's always been this security mindset and this cloud mindset. So we're going to talk about a few of these things today: driver domains, stub domains, Flask, which is also known as security modules. And we're just going to try to do a basic education on what's here and how you can get started. Now, as we know, you know, if you dealt with cloud at all, you know security is the 800-pound gorilla in the room. It's the thing that drives fear into the hearts of IT people. You know, it's the biggest single barrier to cloud adoption from my experience. I worked with a company a few years ago, a startup that was doing cloud architecture back even before the term was in popular notion. So you start talking about clouds to people and you didn't even know what the term was. And immediately when you started to discuss it, the whole notion of security came up. And that became a real hurdle inside the education and the selling process. The second biggest thing, I think, with cloud is the whole change is bad mentality. If you have, you know, gray hairs like I do, you remember IT back like in the 80s. And in the 80s, if you said something changed, that meant something broke. Change was a bad thing. The ideal was that, you know, when you left work at the end of the day and you came back in the next morning, you could say, what happened? Oh, nothing changed. Perfection. Because if something changed, someone got a phone call at 3 a.m. perhaps threatening their job, maybe even questioning their parentage, saying that, you know, we got to get this up now. HR is going to need this by beginning of business. You got to get in here. You know, change was a horrific thing inside the old world of IT. Now comes the cloud, and suddenly we say we're embracing change. If anyone ever been a cloud advocate in your organization, you were the guy that was trying to say, hey, we should do this cloud stuff. You know, if you have, chances are you've got a series of stripes on your back, you know, from being whipped around. Because, you know, and when I talk to, especially to younger people about the subject of cloud, where they're thinking cloud is natural. You know, you go into some older IT folks and you start talking about how good this is, you know, they're horrified. And they're horrified because, you know, it's kind of like going up to your saintly grandmother who goes to church daily and say that you want to become a Satanist. Or it's like going up to a PETA person and say, I want to stomp puppies to death in front of you. You know, it's a visceral reaction because old IT, change was bad. And every time you got a new piece of hardware, you beat the change out of it. You know, you put a runbook together, you took the thing so that, you know, you stuck it in there, you knew everything that box was going to do before you ever turned it on. And then it was okay. Because you took all the change out of the situation and you made it all part of the situation. Cloud just does it the opposite way. And beyond that fear of change, the other big issue is, of course, security. And the thing is that, you know, the gorilla, security, is not a gorilla, it's a red herring. The truth is that the security has always been an issue, but we've denied it as an industry. I mean, I've been with organizations for years that believed, oh yes, what we need is we have our firewall, and our firewall will protect us. Well, anyone who's ever run an Exchange server knows that the firewall is not going to protect you. You know, I worked with a company, you know, years and years ago, just after the Earth's surface cooled. I worked with a company before we had internet, that you had modems. We had sites throughout the country, and we had modems, and you had to dial into the modem. And I remember the VP saying, "Ah, we are so secure because after we call in, we unplug the modem. That's it. We're secure. We're perfect." And it's true for the external cracker coming in. He's not going to be able to easily get past that. However, this was a company that they used to buy other companies, and they'd say, okay, you're now part of us, so you people on this half of the room are fired, and you people on this half of the room are now going to do the work of what all of you did together, and if you don't like it, then you're fired, and we'll bring back one of the other guys who's now looking for a job, because he'll take the job. So they were throwing people under the bus as a matter of business. And the other interesting piece about this situation was that they used common passwords across the country. So if the guy's getting the axe somewhere up in Washington State, and he's been on the phone to his buddy who's down in Florida, and he decides, you know what? Guess what? This sensitive system, the password is blah. Go have yourself a fun time. You know, there were threats. And the problem is, in the old way of thinking, is that we thought we had the firewall or we had this software, whatever it is, therefore the threat is mitigated. No. The thing is, the threats were there, and unfortunately a lot of organizations just didn't want to face the fact. They kind of lucked out with the notion that, okay, no one has gotten ticked off at me so badly that they've finally taken revenge. And so in the cloud, however, we don't have the luxury of believing that. What we have now is the reality that anyone in an external cloud has that possibility of getting in. So I better actually solve the security problem I've always had and not go hiding my head in the sand and say, well, we've already taken care of it when we haven't. So the whole notion of security through obscurity is dead. You can't hide in the corner and say, I'm safe. You're not. So we need to actually think in terms of security. So we can't use security by wishful thinking. You can't just hope in your firewall. That we know that's not going to work. You can't just look in one area of security and ignore other areas of security. We've never had this problem before is not security. So you need to start with the design. You need to, it has to be planned, it has to be implemented at multiple levels, and then individual pieces have to be securable. And this is the sort of thing that goes on inside the Xen Project security protocols. Xen Project is security, has security by design. As I said before, and here's the paper, I didn't know if the slide was in there, and you can find this almost exact deck right now out on xenproject.org in the presentation section. This version will probably be up there soon, but it's literally, the one that's out there is literally identical except for like one slide. and that slide isn't worth much. But there's a paper that can actually, that actually talks about this future day when the thing that we call clouds will exist, and you'll have these dynamic data centers. And that was in people's minds when Xen was born. So it was natural that the hypervisor would be able to thwart these sorts of attacks that come inside a cloud-ish scenario. Now, for folks that may not be Xen architect heads, I'm going to do a 2-minute crash and burn on Xen architecture. No aneurysms, don't worry about it. It's not that difficult. This is a textbook picture of a type 1 hypervisor. That is that you've got your hardware, you have your hypervisor layer, which provides device drivers and models and the scheduler and the MMU and a few other things, and then you've got VMs that sit on top of it. That's your textbook type 1. Now here is a textbook type 2, known as sometimes called a hosted hypervisor, and we see that the picture's just slightly different. On top of the hardware, instead of just having a normal hypervisor layer like you find in type 1, we actually have a host operating system. But as part of that host operating system, there is the hypervisor function. And we see the device drivers reside within the host operating system, and so you have VMs on top and so forth. And you know, the first question I always get when I show something like this is, which is better? Well, the bottom line is whichever works best for you. Because frankly, there are two different ways of solving the same problem. So it's entirely possible that for one payload, type 1 will do a little better. For others, type 2 might do a little better. You know, test and see, whichever works best for your situation. There are, however, security ramifications, and as we're going to see, the type 1 scenario lends itself very well to a number of security scenarios that we'll talk about. Now, what does Xen look like? Well, here we said this is what textbook type 1 is. Xen, similar, but we see there's a slight difference. When you look at the hypervisor layer on the Xen side, you notice that something's missing. Device drivers, models. Now, where do they go? Well, in the Xen world, that goes into the control domain, also known as DOM 0. We put that there within a particular operating system, a Linux or a BSD. Now, what's the advantage of this? How many people worked with Linux back in the 90s? Show of hands? Okay. Anyone remember the good old days of going to your local computer show and you got that piece of hardware that just came out and you think, oh, this is cool, man, I've been waiting to use this. And you go and you plug it in your box and you turn it on and up, no device driver. And so you have to go looking through the you know, the specifications to see, you know, maybe if I upgrade my Linux distribution, you know, maybe that'll do it. Or maybe I got to go out to you know, SourceForge or to Fresh Meat, for people who remember Fresh Meat, and you know, find something and maybe compile it myself, you know, and get it in there to get the thing working. It was exhilarating, but it was the problem you didn't want to solve. You didn't want that. You wanted to be able to just sort of plug the thing in and make it go, because that's, you know, the neat stuff is after you got it running. Well, the Xen architecture says, hey, wait a second, why should we have to burden the hypervisor layer with thousands of device drivers and have them tested and have to work through them all, et cetera, every time some new piece of hardware comes out? It happens that Linux and the BSDs already are doing that and doing it quite well. So what we'll do is we'll just offload the device drivers and device models into this one particular VM known as the control domain. And this is the way Xen looks when you boot it up for the first time. That's a very typical picture. Now, this is a little bit more detailed picture, and this is what we're going to use to pieces of for a few scenarios here today. We see that we've got the hardware layer and the hypervisor layer, and we're going to talk about two particular instances back and forth here in the next few minutes. One is a fully virtualized domain, and the other is a paravirtualized domain. And for folks who aren't Xen heads, You know, you may have heard earlier that initially we dealt with para virtualization, and then when the hardware became smart enough to handle virtualization, we could use hardware virtualization. They have two slightly different characteristics, and as a result, they have two slightly different attack surfaces, and that's kind of what we're going to consider here in the next few minutes. But this is a little bit more detailed description of what Xen might look like. So let's talk for just a second about a security approach. To have a proper security approach, first we need to have some ideas of threat models. In other words, what's at risk? How can someone get to me? What is it that they may be wanting to do, and how would they go about it? So we need to start thinking in terms of scenarios, and it could be that they're trying to access a network. It could be that they have control of one of the guest VMs, and they want to attack the hypervisor layer. So that's what one of the things that we're going to discuss here. We need to also be concerned with, you know, well, what's accessible here? Can they get into certain levels of code? What type of interfaces can they exploit, et cetera? We're not going to go into detail on that, but it's got to be in your head. And the other notion is this notion of defense in depth. And probably the best way of thinking of defense in depth is, you know, a medieval castle. You know, so you have some medieval village, you know, it's out there in the middle of wherever, and people say, well, this is a great little village we have, but what happens if someone attacks us? Well, okay, let's get some archers. Well, that's pretty good. So they get together some archers, and they're ready to attack. But what happens, you know, if these marauding hordes come in and they have shields? Well, they could probably get through our archers. So we'll build a moat. That's what we'll do. We'll keep the archers, but we'll build a moat around the town. And you think, okay, that's good. It'd be harder for them to get across. But what happens if they have shields and they have boats? Well, maybe let's build some walls. That's it. We'll build some walls so that they have to go first. They have to get past the arrows. Then they have to cross the water. Then they have to scale the walls. So it's this defense in depth concept of there is no magic bullet to the security. But if you have layer upon layer upon layer, then the attack from the outside has to become more flexible. It has to become able to adapt, et cetera, and you can manage to wall things off. So we get away from the magic bullet concept and try to work in defense in depth. Now, this is just some of the assumptions we're going to make for the next couple of minutes, that we're going to have a situation where we've got two networks. We've got a control network. We've got a guest network. This next point here about the IOMMU means you have hardware that's been invented in the last 10 years, pretty much. Anything that has virtualization extensions to it is good. We're going to assume that, that all network drivers are in domain zero. And if you're using PV, we're going to assume you're going to be using Pygrub. And if you're using HVM, we're going to assume that you're going to be using QMU as a device model. And for people who didn't hear earlier, I mean, people look at QMU and say, well, that's virtualization. Well, no, we're not using it for the virtualization. We're just using it for the device modeling, because they do really good device modeling, and we don't need to reinvent. So let's take a look at a possible attack of the network interface. Now, this is what that attack might look like. We see the red areas here. The red areas having to do with that rogue domain on the far side there, and that rogue domain could be used to exploit this area in domain zero, which includes, you know, IP tables and all the networking stack. And if they get hold of that, then they can get hold of the guest NIC. So this is what an exploit might look like. And from there, they could do other havoc. So how might this come about? Well, they may be looking at, you know, exploiting bugs in a driver. I remember, jeepers, it's probably about 10, maybe 15 years ago, working with a customer that wasn't doing virtualization. They had hardware, and they had bought in some great new servers, and those great new servers included some great new NICs, you know. It's like, oh, we're gonna plug these things in, we're gonna have all sorts of power. Well, just before they got to the deployment point where they had just racked them all up, the word came that there were some serious bugs in those brand new NICs. And there were no workarounds at the time. This is pre-Linux and anything else. So, I mean, this was using, I think, Solaris at the time, maybe. I'm not sure which. But I remember distinctly that they sent, you know, Joe, whatever his name was, the their lead operator, down to wherever they got miscellaneous hardware from. And he came back with an armful of older NICs. And he and his buddies had a joyous weekend pulling things out of the racks, pulling out those brand new NICs, tossing them, putting in the old NICs, because they knew how to secure the old NIC. They knew the driver was sound. So this is not a new attack surface. This has been around for as long as we've had networking. The interesting thing, and I just mentioned this too, is that the interesting thing about this is that actually in a virtualization platform, we can actually secure it better than you could it when you just had hardware. Because, like I said, the solution of a buggy driver back then was to actually start replacing hardware. Well, we don't have to get to that level, which is really good. Now, they could be looking at some sort of bugs inside, you know, the bridging or the filtering that happens. We have, in power virtualization, we have a thing called netback, net front and net back, which allows the data to go back and forth. It's possible they might try to, you know, exploit something in netback. Now, netback itself is incredibly simple. So the likelihood of exploiting a bug is probably pretty small because there's just not a lot there. But if we're going to be intellectually honest, we have to admit that it's a possibility. So we've got a situation that we're used to. I mean, like I said, this existed in hardware long before it existed in virtualization. Like I said, the netback surface is pretty small. But when this happened in hardware, you ended up changing hardware. But we can actually do something better here. Now, this is the picture again of, you know, the network path compromised. All this red area has now been lost because someone got in there and they managed to get in to the driver area in the control domain. Remember that that driver area in the control domain is going to be something that's going to be running at elevated levels of privilege, potentially. So that's something that could be extremely serious. So you, as a result, if it is, you could end up losing control of your control domain. And if you lose control of your control domain, you could end up losing control of the entire host. So this is a serious situation. Well, what can you do about something like this? Well, one of the concepts is called driver domains. Now, if you notice how the picture's changed, that area that was red over here in domain zero is now in its own domain space. Basically, it's in its own VM that is nothing more than networking code. That's it. So suddenly, if that attack should come from that rogue domain all the way on the far side, it can attack the driver domain, and it might get down to the guest NIC, but what about domain zero, the control domain? Control domain no longer comes into play. So in this scenario, even if they manage to violate the driver domain and they temporarily seize control of the guest NIC, you can't go any further. You haven't gotten the target. If you wanted to get hold of the control domain to get control, you didn't get there. Now, in the cloud, in particular, just about any cloud solution I've worked with, if something happens to the network card, what happens? Something gets rebooted, more than likely. Most of the software I've seen detects that and say, oh, this, something's wrong. So bam. So even though that they've technically won, they've gotten hold of the network, they've also, number one, they haven't gotten whatever it is that they really wanted, because whatever they really wanted is probably over here in domain zero, which they have no access to. And number two, they've started a timer for their own destruction. Because in most cloud scenarios, that thing's about to get rebooted inside some number of seconds. So we have managed to do a level of insulation against by using the driver domain. Now, driver domains are unprivileged. They don't need elevated levels of privilege. It's not part of the control domain, so you're not putting the control domain at risk. And all it's doing is dealing with drivers, so it's a very limited scope. And what's more, even if they get in there, a driver domain deals with drivers. That's it. It doesn't have bash, it doesn't have a database, It doesn't have anything. It's a driver. It's a giant lump of driver. So all that interesting stuff, and you think about, why are people trying to get into your system? Well, maybe they're trying to get your passwords. Maybe they're trying to get your data. Maybe they're trying to get your sales figures. Whatever it is, maybe they're trying to look at your next generation whatever. You're not going to find that sitting in a driver. And like I said, on top of it, chances are, if it's cloud, it started a self-destruct reboot timer somewhere along the line. So the compromised picture now looks like this. Domain zero is clear. It's not even under attack. And the amount of damage that they can do inside that red area is very, very limited. Net results. Yeah, they win a driver domain, but they can't do anything with it, more than likely, because there's nothing there. They can interrupt the guest network traffic for a while until it gets reset. But chances are that's not what they were going after to begin with. So that's going to be nice and frustrating for them. You will temporarily lose control of the NIC. But once again, if they have to exploit that, they have to be able to write an exploit, a new type of exploit, in the driver domain without use of tools, because there isn't any. So they better be really, really smart on top of it. So this is a nice level of defense. Is it complete and all-encompassing? No. That's why we're doing security in depth. It's one of the techniques that you can use. Now, how do you go about doing this? You can create a VM with the appropriate drivers, and you can use any distribution suitable as a control domain, like you always do. There are some hot plug scripts. You give it the physical access. You do a little network topology. And then you add a line that you see there to the domain. And that's pretty much it. And there's the wiki page that'll actually run you through step by step. It's not a particularly complex solution. But it's one that you have to make that decision, like I said before. Because by default, those drivers are going to be in domain zero. If you want them out of the domain zero, you have to go through this process. Once again, not difficult. You just have to know to do it. And once again, that link is going to be on the slide, is on the slide deck that's out on zenproject.org under the presentation area. Now, what's another possible exploit? Another one has to do with PyGrub. Now, PyGrub, as we can see here, I mean, here's the here's what a normal tool stack looks like. PyGrub, as you might guess, is a Python equivalent to grub used inside a PV situation in power virtualization. And normally it sits within the tool stack that resides on domain zero, on the control domain. So that's what the image looks like. And what it does is the same thing that grub does. So it looks at the file system, and it gives, it parses grub.conf, and it gives you choices as to what were you going to boot up for this VM. Now, what happens if there is an assault here? Let's say that someone has compromised the guest disk, and that guest disk now puts PyGrub at stake along with the domain builder. So these things are now becoming at risk because of someone's exploit. And it may try to exploit, a bug in the system parser, in the menu parser, in the domain builder. All of these things are possible, even if they're not overly likely, but it's all possible. This is the same sort of issue we've dealt with in hardware. So what happens if it's exploited? Well, suddenly you could lose all this area, and anything that's in red is in trouble. And that's not good. So how do we get around this sort of thing, a PyGrub-based attack? As we said, it could lead to everything. So one way of doing it is to use fixed kernels. And chances are, if you're running in production, you're already doing that. If you're doing it in a lab or something of the sort where you're allowing people to pick what kernel they want, then you might still be using Pygrub. But if you're using in production, chances are you're already using a fixed kernel. And the fixed kernel just basically says, hey, you're going to run what I tell you to run, and that's the end of it. We know the kernel's good because it's, you know, sitting here inside my repository as a system administrator. I'm not giving you a choice. I'm not allowing you to compromise anything. And it just removes that element of attack. And of course, the downside is that it means that your admins now have to stay on top of all your kernel functions. But like I said, in production, they already are. But what happens if you don't want to do this? What happens if you want to give someone the opportunity to pick which kernel to boot from? Well, for that, we have pvgrub. And we notice that pvgrub, where pygrub sat in the realm of domain zero, in the control domain, pvgrub now resides over in its own domain, along with something called miniOS and the guest disk. What's pvgrub? Once again, it's doing the job of grub, but it's sitting on top of a thing called miniOS, which is, or miniOS, depending on who you talk to, which is basically just that. It's a very small operating system which is, gives just enough life to the system to be able to go through the boot process. That's all it does. And so the combination of pvgrub and miniOS is kind of the equivalent of a BIOS and the normal grub. That's all it is. So it's taking it together. And do I have the picture in there? No. Let me go back to the original picture. Oh. There we go. And if you know, see what happens here is that even if someone managed to munge the guest disk, what happens? Well, all you have there that's exposed is that domain itself. The worst it can do is get hold of a guest domain. What happened to domain zero? It's not using any code from domain zero, so there is no exploit. So the risk has now been mitigated tremendously by keeping it all within a guest VM, which in this, the scope of things is much less powerful. Now, how do we deal with pvgrub? It's really rather simple. You look for the existence of this image, and that's where it normally lives in user lib xen boot. In Debian and SLES-based images, you still need to build this for yourself, although it's pretty easy to do. It's already included in Fedora. You need to add one configuration line, as it shows here, inside the guest configuration, and that's pretty much it. I mean, this is not heavy lifting, and we can see here, you know, follow the wiki page, it'll go, you know, lead you through the how-to. The other good news, too, pvgrub, up until recently, was a separate piece of code, and with, I think, grub 2.02, it is now actually part of the actual grub 2 code itself. So pvgrub is now an alternate object, and it's going to be maintained because it's actually part of the grub 2 project. So that's good news too. So this is another technique that's, you know, really useful. Now, what else can be attacked? Well, the device models through QEMU, and here's, you know, the general picture that we showed before. We see the device model up there. It resides in the control domain. So we can see that if there is an attack that goes against the device model, it has the possibility of doing something nasty within the control domain itself. QEMU, as we said, has virtualization capabilities, but we don't use it for that. We use it just for device modeling. And so that's all it's used for. The what sort of exploits might it use? You know, well, it could be a bug inside one of the emulators of its devices. I mean, all that's possible. QEMU is actually a really good project, but it's possible it has bugs from time to time. So that's the type of exploit that may be used. And once again, if it's actually successfully attacked, you know, the control domain user space could go, and once the control domain user space goes, you know, an inventive cracker could take the whole system out. So what do you do to thwart something like this? Well, we use what's known as a stub domain. And a stub domain is a small service domain that only runs that particular modeling code. So a stub domain is here kind of what a driver domain is to a driver. It's a separate little VM box that will be used to just hold a copy of QMU. Now what happens if you win that? Well, guess what? You know, you were out to conquer the world and you just conquered Luxembourg. You've got a domain that just has QMU code. It doesn't have a disk, it doesn't have a network, it doesn't have anything. It's just a device model. It doesn't even have bash, for crying out loud. So once again, it could be an annoyance, but in terms of risk for the total system, very small. And if you did actually do this, you'd need to figure out an entirely different attack to try to attack something else on the system, because it's so limited, it just doesn't have much. Now, on top of it, we're going to talk in a moment about running Flask with these things, or the Xen Security Modules, which, when you combine with ideas of stub domains, driver domains, becomes an even more powerful security tool. So how do we deal with QMU stub domains? Well, this slide looks suspiciously like the last one that I just discussed. In fact, it's almost identical in concept. You have to make sure that the image exists. You may have to build it yourself, depending on which distribution you use, or it may already be included. SLES 12, I heard, may actually have it if you're running SUSE. I haven't gotten verification. I should go ask the SUSE guy in the other room. Maybe he knows. And basically, you turn on a configuration item inside the configuration, and then just follow the how-to. It isn't particularly difficult, but you have to decide to do it. Now, maybe someone wants to attack the hypervisor itself. How would you go about that? Well, in the PV world, maybe you're looking to attack PV hypercalls, and the hypercalls are the things that allow the paravirtualized guests to talk to the hypervisor layer to get what they need out of the hypervisor. On the full hardware virtualized guests, you know, you could use the HVM hypercalls, which are only a subset. You could look at the instruction emulation, maybe you can find a bug in there, or maybe you could do one of these emulated platform devices. There are different ways that could be attacked there. One way to remedy that would be to try to stick with PV, because PV has a much smaller attack surface than hardware virtualization. Now, let's talk for a moment about Flask, or the Xen Security Modules. This is really a terrific capability. How many people have worked with SE Linux? Okay, the good news is you can have the exact same aneurysm you have working with SE Linux while working with VMs. Isn't that great? Your day is now complete. Flask is actually, you know, developed by the same wonderful people at the NSA who helped develop SE Linux. And with all the accusations floating around about things having to do with the NSA, I've yet to hear anyone accuse them of not understanding security. And so the security modules are really a very powerful and potent way of putting walls around VMs, not just in the same way that SE Linux does, which is interested in processes and so forth, but rather, Flask actually is designed with the VM in mind, and in particular with the Xen VM in mind. It uses the same sort of concepts, but it can actually restrict which hypercalls are being used. So, you could just make it so certain hypercalls are only available for certain VMs. And you can even go even more fine-grained than that. But I mean, think about it. Now, we talked a bit few minutes ago about things like driver domains. Now, what happens if you wrap driver domains with all sorts of hypercall and other restrictions? You can make it so not only if they violate it, they win this little box that is non-privileged and really doesn't have much, but you can actually lock it so that all that that network driver can do is talk on a network, period, end of discussion. So it really doesn't matter if they're brilliant enough to figure out a way to exploit this new thing that they won. The fact is, it can't talk to anything other than what you told it to talk to. Likewise, stub domains, same thing. If it can only do certain hypercalls, if it can only talk to certain devices, you can just wrap that sucker up tight. So that, yes, they might be able to win a box, but they have absolutely nothing inside by the time that they've won it. They've managed to be an annoyance, and not much more. Nothing is at risk. It's a really great concept. Now, Flask does come with a test policy, and in just like the same way that one does not take an SE Linux policy that someone else wrote and you put it on your production machine and say, ah, turn it on, let's see what happens. This is not a good idea. Okay, so, you know, make sure that when you start goofing around with the test policy that it fits, number one, with the type of thing you're doing. The number two thing is that the test policy is just that, it's a test policy. So when we're doing testing and stuff like this on different releases, there's some nominal testing that goes on against the test policy, but it's not really, huge amount of testing. So you're going to want to tweak this to make sure it fits your application and your concept. That just kind of makes sense anyway with any security policy, but just be aware of that. We're just about out of time here. How do you use the Flask policy? You build it with XSM enabled. You add a couple of lines here into the config file, depending on what you want to do. And then you just follow the notes. And like I said, you know, if you're an SE Linux head, it's really not too bad. If SE Linux gives you headaches, Flask will give you headaches just as well. But it's no worse. And that's really all it is. And then you can adjust, of course, policies according to what you need to have done. Let me just spend 1 minute here on ARM. One of the really neat stories about Xen has to do with its ARM support. You know, and here's a picture of the ARM architecture as implemented in, you know, V7 and going forward. You've got a user mode, you've got a kernel mode, you've got a hypervisor mode, and then you've got your device tree. Well, Xen fits there, right on top of the hypervisor mode. That's it. It doesn't have to cross into any other mode to get its job done. The kernel space and user space map into the kernel space and user space. I mean, you know, when I talk to Stefano over in England, who does a lot of our ARM work, you know, he was practically giddy explaining the architecture. He said, this is the same, it's like they implemented the same spec. It fits. We don't have to do mode changes. You don't have to go into elevated privilege. You don't have to waste a lot of time. That's why the ARM code is so small compared to the x86 code, because it fits. You don't have to do anything tricky. From a security standpoint, what does that mean? Well, it means it never goes into kernel code. So therefore, you can't have a kernel level of attack, because there's no code there. It is, you know, it's running what it normally runs. Whatever in the VM runs in the kernel mode, that's all it runs. But the hypervisor doesn't have to go there. So there is no exploit because it doesn't go. It's actually incredibly useful. Not only is it more efficient, but from a security standpoint, it's a whole lot more secure than, say, a type 2 hypervisor, which is going to have to go back and forth and do, you know, mode switching. And the final piece, of course, is that, well, you've got that device tree. Well, guess what? That plays the same game that we play now. We just we load the device drivers and model thing inside DOM 0, and bing. That's it. And as I said, this is just what I said anyway. And that's pretty much it. There is a wiki page on securing Xen, which is well worth a read. My thanks to George Dunlop, who did the original presentation for this, and Stefano, as I said, who does a lot of the arm work. Any issues or questions, xenproject.org. That's the center of our universe, if you don't know it already. It's really good. So, thank you. Okay.